Hey everybody, this is super duper producer Louis B. I just wanted to remind everyone to like, comment, share, and subscribe. And don't forget to hit that notification bell. This helps with the algorithm and helps other people find this podcast. Thus helps Mercedes put light on her case. You can subscribe to this podcast on Spotify, iTunes, iHeart, YouTube, and various other podcast platforms. Thank you in advance and enjoy the show. Once the most electrifying woman in pornography is now facing false charges in San Bernardino County, California, sitting in jail for almost half a decade without a trial. She's exposing the corruption within the legal system. Calling from the West Valley Detention Center in San Bernardino County, you are listening to Behind the Walls with Mercedes Carrera.
Hello, hello. It is March 6th, 2024. Thank you so much for setting me up today. I'm sorry I've been absent. I was given a discipline here at wonderful West Valley Resort and Spa for ordering a block of non-kosher cheese. And so let me give you the background on this. I have been on the kosher diet for years here, and God has blessed me wonderfully for having... So you can be on a religious kosher diet here. Really, there are many people here who are on the kosher diet who are not religious, who are not Jewish. They just say that they are, and they get to be on this kosher diet. This is very common in jail. I, however, am religious, and I'm on the kosher diet for religious reasons. It's never been an issue. I was warned one time, I think it was 2 years ago, I ordered a lady here, so ironically, it was very religious. I ordered her a bag of Cheetos, and I got a warning for it almost immediately. And I never did it again. That was the one time I ordered something that was non-kosher. Okay. Other than that, I always keep kosher. I'm actually really particular for it. Anyhow, so they did an audit. They did a superfluous audit on our kosher ordering. Well, I always order kosher. The only food item that we can really order here that's like supplementary to our diet are ramen noodles. Now, ramen noodles are not kosher. I don't order them. I don't like them. Most of the chips and junk food, chips especially, like, I don't know, Cheetos and Doritos and stuff like that, those are not kosher. I don't know why. There's probably some additive in them, or maybe they don't pay for the kosher, whatever. There's some chips that are kosher. They're listed on the yeah, I usually order saltines, so I don't care. Anyway, well, a lot of the items on the kiosk that show up kosher are not, I guess, marked kosher in their inventory. So some things like cheese, their juice, they have these little juice packets, sugar. It's not really sugar, it's dextrose, like equal salt, things like that. But it shows up kosher. It either has a K or a KSA or a U with a circle around it. If you see a U with a circle around it, it's with hoof, it's kosher. Anyhow, but it's still kosher. It shows up. So anyway, I've been compliant. So they do a kosher audit. Deputy shows up with a discipline that says, oh, well, if you've been compliant, they'll probably zero it out. Okay, fine. I come back from court on Friday. Who shows up but Detective Pat, the detective on my case, who is now a sergeant. He moonlights as a sergeant here in the jail. Now, this is a conflict of interest, you would think. But Sergeant Patton shows up with his clipboard. He might as well have a swastika armband on. His mustache is literally 1 millimeter shy of being the mustache that Der Fuhrer wears, right? He comes to my door. He's extremely hostile. Sit in yourself. Sit in yourself. Like, okay. He's like, you have ordered not kosher food either. I'm like, all right. I mean, I was told it was just a block of cheese by the deputy the day before. But all right. He's like, there are multiple items. Multiple. Okay. He's like, I want to know where you went to synagogue. I want the name of your rabbi. I want the phone number of your rabbi. So he starts calling my religion into question. Now, anyway, if they were a real detective, you would think he had done detective work, right? You can go on my Twitter and see I talked about being Jewish before. Half of the porn industry is Jewish. Now, I have a theory about this, that we are actually in the end time. And if you notice, I think God's calling a lot of his people back to him. Like, if it's like, you know, Ron Jeremy, he was put in jail, right? What's his name? James Dean, he's Jewish. He was falsely accused. So I think that God right now is trying to pull a lot of his people out of the industry. This is kind of an aside. But I've noticed that there are a lot of people that are being pulled out of the industry right now, and God's trying to pull all of it back to him. Because it's mostly those of us who are Jewish. And so I think this is God trying to actually save us, preserve us. And this is a separate theory I have. But anyway, so he starts calling my faith into question, which is actually completely out of his wheelhouse. I mean, he's technically supposed to be there questioning me about my kosher diet. He's telling me, well, I'm going to have the rabbi come see you. And I'm like, I would love to speak to the rabbi. I think that would be wonderful. I talk to the chaplain here all the time about my faith. And the chaplain and I have actually become, I think we have pretty good rapport. So that's fantastic. So he's calling my faith into question. I've become deeply religious in my time here, because when you're in jail, you have a couple of options. You can either become really criminal, or you can become very religious. I mean, I guess you can kind of go the middle path, but it isn't, you know, when you're in a cell all day, you can have time to introspect, or you can either act out, or you can become very introspective, right? And I think that Herr Patton is pissed off because I haven't become, I don't act like some depraved slut here. That makes him angry, because his profiling of me was incorrect. Because he's not a good detective. He doesn't do his job well, you know? So he's yelling at me. I mean, he might as well be yelling in German. And he's like, these items are not kosher. That's mixed kosher. It's kosher. That's how the jalapenos are mixed kosher. I'm like, jalapenos are kosher. Like, I'm showing him the package. It says KSA on it. They're mixed kosher. They're Mexicana. And I'm like, they are. They're kosher. It's KSA, you know? He's like, oh, no, the juice. That's just, it's kosher. It's kosher. And I'm like, it's kosher. It is kosher. You know, so he's turning red. His swastika armband is trembling. His little, you know, pure mustache is prickling. And he's getting madder and madder. And I'm showing him that all these things have a yield. I pulled out my whole commissary bag. He's yelling at me. I'm starting to get upset and starting to cry. And I'm like, what do you want from me? I'm completely compliant. He's calling my faith into question. This is the man who's taken my daughter. He's taken my career. He's taken my life. He's taken everything I have. Now he's trying to take my religion from me. Like I'm under religious persecution. This is how much power this facility has given this person over me. I mean, it's ridiculous.
Over a fucking block of cheese.
Over a block of cheese. Yeah, the San Bernardino Soviet has put me under a kosher pogrom over a block of cheese. And I want to point out, like, there are like five women in this unit who are on the kosher diet. Not a single one of them was subjected to this except for me. I was the only one. It was just me. So he screams at me. He calls my religion into question. He is unwilling to hear anything I have to say. And at the end of it, he slams the door and walks away. You know, this is your due process. This is your liberty and freedom, America. America is the USSR. You know, and people don't realize, it was not just the Nazi Reich and fascism that did this. Like, I was reading, I had a lot of time while I was out by this to read. I'm reading this great book called The People's Tragedy about the Bolshevik Revolution. And in the Ukraine, prior to the Bolshevik Revolution, there was something called blood libel. It was the Violet Affair, where the Ukrainian accused this completely innocent Jewish man of murdering a Ukrainian boy. He was found dead in a cave stabbed 13 times. And so they got all worked up in a frenzy. They were always accusing the Jews of everything. They put this Jewish man on trial. It was actually his friend's mother was involved in gangs that were looting and stealing and robbing, whatever. And so he found out about it, threatened to go to the cops, I guess. And so the gang murdered him, put his body in a cage, and they accused the completely innocent Jewish man. Well, the cops knew who did it. They knew. And they still framed him up anyway and put him on trial and paid paid witnesses that were all completely, I mean, these witnesses were, it was a joke. The whole thing was a joke. You can look it up, the vilest press. And I mean, this is what they were doing in the pre-Soviet Union days, in Ukraine. It was called the blood libel. And look, this goes back well into the Middle Ages and before. So, I mean, you know what happened during the Holocaust? It was just the latest iteration of this. This anti-Semitism. And it's, you know, it's starting to rear its ugly head here in America right now, too, which means that we're going to go into a third world war. It's coming. So what I'm feeling in here is just like, it's the bubble of what's coming. It's going to come. You know, I was reading, if you look up, it's Matthew 24, Luke 21, and Mark 13 in your New Testament. You know, nations will go to war with each other. You're gonna see this. I mean, I really think we're nearing these end times. Because, you know, I believe Jesus was a prophet. That's what I believe. And so he was saying, hey, you're going to see this. You're going to see these end times. And so, I'm feeling this, and I'm going, wow, here we are. Here we are again. And people are going to be falsely accused. These horrible things are going to happen. it's horrendous. It's horrendous. And, I'm horrified. I'm horrified by it because nothing's sacred. Nobody's safe. The state allows it. The state encourages it. You know, all these Americans who are all just rah, 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 rah. You know, I watched part of the, Super Tuesday. All these people think that Trump's going to save them. Trump's not going to save you. Trump's not going to save you. So many of these people who are supporting Trump are pro-police. The police are not going to save you. The police are the problem. I agree with Black Lives Matter. The police are the problem. If you think that the cops are going to save you, you're wrong. Like, look, this is one of the problems. Like, I was reading about the Bolshevik Revolution. The people who are on the side of the Tsar, there was something called the Black Hundred. The Black Hundred were, I mean, you would almost call them bad. They were like proto-fascists. You know, fascism is like Nazism. That's always going to be a problem. That's going to be a problem. If you think that authority is going to help you, you're wrong. And that's the problem with the Trump supporters. They think that the state is going to help you. The state are people like Patton, and they're bad, and they're wrong. It's not going to help you. It's not going to help. Because there are people like Patton who think that they're on the side of right, and humans are wrong. And they're flawed. They make these decisions that are wrong. And they will oppress you. Trump's not going to help you. Biden's not going to help you. Like, we are careening off a cliff here. So, I don't know. I mean, God help us all, really. I'm horrified. Horrified by everything that's happening in society. And I don't know if there's going to be some third party intervention. Maybe God will help us all, but these are very scary times we live in. Very scary times. I read, thank you to my very well educated friend who sent me Starship Troopers. I highly recommend it as a read for everybody. Read Starship Troopers. Have you read it, Lily?
I've seen the movie.
No, you got to read the book. So read the book. The book is brilliant because it's a commentary on society. And obviously the author, I'm assuming, was some sort of World War II veteran. Because he must have been a paratrooper. A friend of mine sent me Jake McNeese's the story of Jake McNeese, which I read right before Starship Troopers, which is really a wonderful lead into it, because it filled me in so much on paratroopering, and I guess that's the way you say it. So it was really great that I read that first. But the idea of, instead of compulsory service, voluntary service as a means of securing one's citizenship, that's a brilliant idea. You've got to read Starship Troopers. Get that book. I think everybody should really read that. It's a really poignant look at society, and he delves into topics that are so apropos to today. Like, for example, he talks about corporal punishment and how necessary it is. And there are people in jail. One of the girls here is writing somebody who gets in jail for spanking his kids. Think about that for a second.
Yeah.
They can put you in jail for spanking your kids.
I used to get them country ass whoopings.
That's crazy, right? So you can't discipline your children. Now, what message does it send to children? You know, the state has more power than your parents. So now you can threaten your parents, and you learn that at a young age. So you are usurping parental authority within the home. So kids learn very early on, well, I'm just going to call the cops on you. And that's, it reminds me of, in 1984, there's a very interesting passage in the very beginning of the book where it talks about how all the children became little monsters because they learned that the state has more power than their own parents.
Well, yeah, they'll just say, I'll call the cops. You can't hit me. Like,
Right. I go back to Pushkin's poem. And these are days of infamy. Man's choice is but to be a tyrant, traitor, or prisoner. No other choice has he. So it makes tyrants of them.
Mm-hmm.
It foments a very, you know, problematic personality. So how do you expect these children then to respect authority if they don't learn it in their home? It creates a spirit of rebellion, you know? Ironically.
Yeah.
It's an interesting concept. But he talks about that. He talks about a lot of other interesting ideas. I mean, there's, you know, I haven't seen the movie, so I wasn't. I think movies a lot of times ruin books.
Well, yeah. I mean, because in the book, Johnny Rico is Filipino, but in the movie, he's played by Casper Van Dien, a white guy.
Oh, right. Yeah, I mean, I don't, you know, I think in the book, his race really isn't that important.
Right.
Because it's more about, you know, the idea of, you know, humans have spread to different planets, and there's interplanetary wars against these alien invaders. But it's more about the sociological aspect of if humans are to survive, you know, how would we have self-organized?
You have 1 minute left.
Very important, you know. I think it's very true. How would we survive? How would this happen? And right now, I mean, we're on a collision course to disaster. We are about to commit cosmicide. Just on our own. We're not even facing external enemies. There are no aliens threatening our existence. We're just about to kill ourselves. Just because we all can't get along. We're about to kill ourselves and about to kill the planet. Just because we can't figure this out. Think about that. That's how pathetic humanity is. Yeah, let me call you back.
Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on Spotify. Also, go to justiceformercedescarrera.com. That's justice, the number 4, mercedescarrera.com.
Hello. Well, continuing on with what I was saying. You know, the thing is, I think, you know, I haven't had time to read it until being here. Not that I've had time to read it. I think part of the reason the Bible is so hard to understand, to read, it's dense, it's it's hard to read translations for me, things like Hebrew to English. I'm sure it's more entertaining to read it if you read it in the original Hebrew and understand it. But a lot of it is prophecy, right? So, like, I was reading Zephaniah yesterday. And I was reading Zephaniah, I was reading part of Isaiah, and I think part of Ezekiel. And, I really recommend everyone go on to the Herbert Armstrong Bible study. Go on there, and if you do nothing else, just do the first three Bible study courses, because they talk about the end times, and so they're cited Bible verses, really important to read. And I've done a lot of Bible study in jail, like this Bible study all over jail. They love this in Bible study to prisoners and inmates. Which is a big thing, right? And most of them will focus on Jesus died on the cross for your sins, Jesus died on the cross for your sins, repent, you know. It's so part of the reason I really couldn't get into it. It's hard for me to suspend my disbelief on that. If you could, a lot of that is old pagan belief, the idea of a man God who died on the cross for sin. I can't do that. Like it's really hard. But if you really read the Bible and you read what Jesus prophesied, now you can get into, like, the meat on it. And what he was actually saying was, hey, humans are on a collision course to disaster, which is where we're at right now. We're here. Like, humans have enough nuclear bombs to blow this planet up 50 times over and kill everybody on it and everything on it. We're at the end time. We're here. We're going to do it, unless something stops us. And it's not just Jesus, and it's not just Habakkuk, and it's not just Zephaniah, and it's not just Isaiah, and it's not just Ezekiel. Like, I had this book, Graham Hancock, about there's this thing called, I'm going to say this wrong, Göbekli Tepe, something like that. They found these obelisks buried in Turkey that literally point to right now, at this time, right now, they have these inscriptions on them that are all astronomical. And they talk about, and these things were made, they don't know if they were made 20,000, they think it was like 20,000 years ago. And they are pointing to the astronomy of right now. They talk about some sort of collision course in the cosmos right now. Something's going to happen right now. Everything's pointing to right now. Right now, right now, right now. So is it interstellar? Is it just that humanity goes through these cycles? Are we the new Atlantis? Is this what Atlantis was? The civilization, you know, makes all this technology and then always screws the pooch, destroys itself? I don't know. But this is what they were talking about. This is it. We're here. And so we all have a responsibility to figure this out. And, you know, I hate to use this kind of trice, but get right with God. Because we all, I think there's a certain energy that we all carry. And we all have to say, okay, what am I not doing? How am I contributing to this nasty energy on the planet? How am I contributing to the dross that's here? Like, I believe that God gave me this opportunity and said, you're not living correctly. I'm pulling you out of this. And I'm going to give you 5 years in contemplation so you get it right. And God's doing that to a lot of his people. Look, if I had still been in the industry for the last 5 years, I would have been subject to, there's a lot of, first of all, the COVID shot. I'm going to tell you right now, there's something in those shots. So the Red Cross has put a warning on its website about, hey, if you took those shots and you're going to donate blood, let us know. Yeah. What does that tell you? Everybody in the adult industry was mandated to get every single one of those shots. Mandated. And if I had been in that industry at that time, I would stupidly done it. additionally, the industry was like, hey, Mercedes, hey, we really want you to come dump for these antivirals, those PrEP antivirals for HIV. So those things cause renal failure. And I would have done it. Additionally, hey, by the way, you know what reemerged in the industry? Syphilis, antibiotic resistant gonorrhea, all manners of diseases. So God has protected me. As horrible as it is, God has protected me with it.
How is that possible with all these stringent checks that the industry is supposed to have?
Yeah, so let me tell you a story. Right before I was arrested, I got a text message from someone in the industry saying, hey, don't work with these guys because they were just in Eastern Europe and they were exposed to syphilis. And they got antibiotic treatment before they came back to try to cover it up. So you really shouldn't work with them because they were fully exposed. And these were big names. It was like this big thing. And I was like, shit, well, what do I do? And they were like, well, you know, I really would work with them, but you take the chances. And so here's the thing. Like, they were like, no, they're fine. Well, if they were exposed to it sometime in that 2-week period after they got tested, it wouldn't show up because they had gotten tested and then they were exposed and they were still working. Let's say they got a penicillin shot, right?
Right.
Yeah, yes, you get tested every 2 weeks, but you work in between, right? Hmm. I mean, these people are, you know, especially if they're working in Eastern Europe, and not to mention, oh, by the way, while I've been in jail, I have heard and seen from these girls who are, like, working the streets, syphilis is back, and because these people are stupid idiots, they don't take their antibiotic treatment seriously or correctly, and so it becomes antibiotic resistant. And it takes like 6 months to treat. That's a very serious disease that will kill you. And you want to talk about an act of God? The one Pfizer plant that creates the antibiotic for syphilis was hit by a tornado. Look it up. Talk about God being displeased. Boom. Rip the roof off of it. So yeah, people get tested every 2 weeks, but you're still exposed in between. Same with gonorrhea, antibiotic-resistant gonorrhea.
Yeah.
And you know how bad those antibiotics are for you? They're terrible. Mm-hmm. I mean, I look back on the amount of exposure I had to people's germs, and I think I was absolutely insane. Because after living around so many people here, I'm like, I'm still grossed out by people. There's a reason the deputies here wear gloves.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, it's not nearly as safe as everybody pretends it is. And look at all these celebrities that now are getting these weird disorders. Like, Wendy Williams now has, Parkinson's or advanced dementia. She's only 58.
What happened with Wendy Williams? I don't pay attention.
She has advanced dementia.
Yeah, she's 59, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, like, all these celebrities now are just, you know, dropping dead. And it's because, you know, they took all those weird shots. I mean, that's why they didn't want anybody opposing those shots. They don't want anybody saying anything against that. Anything you can't say, think about this, anything you can't say publicly is probably true. So if I can't come out and say, hey, you know what? Those Pfizer and Merck shots, those are probably killing people. And they're like, oh, we're going to arrest you for that. Or it means it's probably true.
Yeah. Don't forget the buttery biscuit.
Because look at all these celebrities now. And they were all the people that were absolutely stumping for it. Oh, go get the shot. Trust the science. And now they're all, like, one by one, they're getting sick and they're dying. Notice that. You know, I was like, I wasn't going to let them give me a shot in jail. Are you kidding? You know, they were trying to give us the Johnson & Johnson one. And they were trying to give it to us after they had pulled it. So the Johnson & Johnson shot had been taken, it had been pulled for the general public. They had rescinded it, right? And then they were still offering it to those of us who are inmates. They're like, yeah, we know that this probably causes blood clots, but hey, do inmates want it? Or like, no? No thanks.
Yeah, I was just doing some Googling about Wendy Williams. Apparently, her son says that she was drinking a lot. So,
I'm sure they're going to cover it up.
Yeah,
I mean, still, that's not, look, I mean, I have family members who have been alcoholics into their 80s. It doesn't cause that. So when does alcohol cause advanced dementia at the age of 58, 59? Come on. Like, all of Puerto Rico would have dementia at 58, 59.
Well, yeah.
Right?
And we're not that drunk.
Yeah, we are.
No, we're not.
Yeah, we are.
I mean, I don't touch alcohol.
She had fallen down on that show of a show one time. No, but I mean, notice it, and notice all the celebrities that are having those weird disorders. Or even like Justin and Haley Bieber, remember they had that weird neurological disorder right after the COVID shots came out.
Yeah,
and I know people personally who, a lot of people in the medical field, they had gotten the shot. There was one, was a friend of a friend, my friend, it was his wife. As a doctor, took those shots, boom, went to sleep, didn't wake up. Why do you think they were arresting people for questioning it online?
Yeah, isn't that like freedom of speech?
What?
Isn't that like freedom of speech?
You don't have freedom of speech in this country. I mean, anybody who thinks you have freedom of speech in this country, go online and say the COVID shots killed people or the election was rigged. Come on.
A freedom of speech in this country.
It's like, I don't know when Americans are going to get this. The United States is not a free country. The United States is about to go into World War III. If you have money, get out now. The United States resembles Weimar Germany. I mean, I'm in jail. So, you know, they can't put me in extra jail for saying this. What are they going to do, arrest me?
Yeah.
I spent 5 years reading history. This country right now resembles Germany pre-World War II. If I had money, I would be getting out right now. Like, you guys all want to build that wall. I'm like, you don't want a wall. You want to be able to get out of here.
Yeah, no one thinks it's going to keep you, a wall to keep you in. They think it's a wall to keep them out.
Yeah, they're so stupid. They don't realize that. I mean, I feel bad for the people trying to get in right now. I was like, why do you want to come here? There's no work here.
Well, no, they're not coming here for the work. They're coming in here for the welfare.
But the money's not going to be worth anything soon. Like, I guess the president of El Salvador was talking at the CPAC. Somebody was telling me about this, the Conservative Political Activism or Action Committee, something, conference. And he called America out and he said, look, you guys have a really serious choice to make at this next election. I mean, personally, I think it's a false choice anyway. I think it's moot. But he said, hey, your country is about to become very poor. Look, China and Russia are already dealing with each other in the yuan renminbi. Once the planet realizes that the U.S. dollar is toilet paper, the standard of living in this country is going to collapse to the standard of Latin America. We're very close to that. I mean, I already live in third world conditions. Like, I'm already there. So for me, this is not going to be a surprise. But for the rest of America, like, once the rest of America realizes that this country is a third world country, there's going to be a reckoning. it's going to be like what happened to Argentina in the 1980s, because the Argentine people thought that they were wealthy. And then there was a collapse, and then they had... I remember reading this guy. He went for the name Furfel, and he wrote a kind of a memoir about it. And he said it was just this horrific thing where suddenly the Argentinians realized, oh, wow, we're poor. And this is what's going to happen to America, but it's going to be much worse. It's going to be much more violent. And because Americans don't seem to realize, hey, there's no work, and your money's toilet paper. And it's a much more crowded country. And you're not entitled to a damn thing. You're not entitled to a damn thing. And Americans are lazy. That's the other thing. So.
Yeah.
It's, I mean, that's the other problem.
I mean, there was there's this person on TikTok who basically is mocking Americans, saying, I don't have to work. I have the trick.
You have 1 minute left.
The trick is to come to this country and have a child here. My daughter allows me not to work because they give me everything because she's American. You know, I'm getting everything paid for because of you taxpayers.
That's the worst. The welfare state is the worst thing that has ever happened to this country. It's literally the worst thing. And Eisenhower warned about it. It's amazing how much America changed in 70 years. It's just horrifying when you really read American history and then you see what happened to America. And you go, how is this the same country? How did this happen? Let me call you back. I have an idea. Hold on.
The caller has hung up.
Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on Spotify. Also, go to justiceformercedescarrera.com. That's justice, the number four, mercedescarrera.com.
Okay, so I want to thank Captain Carbine for sending me this. I hope, Captain Carbine, you're getting my letters. I've sent... I think three or four. I received one back for inadequate postage, which I don't understand because I've been putting two stamps on all of them. But anyway, so Captain Carbine sent me this great letter. He reminded me of the name of the lecturer. His name is Yuri Bezmenov. And the lecture is called Subversion and Active Measures. Now, I watched this, over 20 years ago. I must have been 18 at the time. It's on YouTube. They take it off YouTube all the time, I would imagine. Yuri Bezmenov, Subversion and Active Measures. And he talks about how to take over a nation without a single shot being fired. So phase one is demoralization. You spread doubt and discontent within the nation's people. Destabilization, which is destabilize the government, institutions, corporations, and organizations, and turn them against the nation until it falls apart. And then crisis. At this point, society's collapsed. The nation has fallen apart to the point where the citizens cry out for a savior who will save them from their pain and suffering. And phase four, normalization. So at that point, the parasites have taken over the nation through complete ideological dominance. Now, this is a Marxist ideology. Now, if you really read about Marxism presupposes, it's 19th century Marxism presupposes that if you look at the Bolshevik Revolution, it was actually premature, because especially the Mensheviks means the minority party, the Bolsheviks were the majority party. They actually believed that Russia was not ready for the revolution. They believed that society has to go through a bourgeois capitalistic phase before communism or socialism could take hold. So I believe what they did here was they're actually taking over Western civilization. They had this idea of the workers of the world unite, that there was going to be a proletariat socialist revolution. And I think what they've done is they have infiltrated all of the Western government to create their communist revolution. They did it quietly. I think Obama was the first real communist president. I think he was a communist ruler, so everybody was like, he was a Muslim. He wasn't. He was communist. If you really look at his, oh, I'm sorry for the TV. God, it's terrible. It's The Simpsons, and it's terrible, of course. See, you know, every time I get on a real point, it's Satan. I'm in Satan's house, and Satan will interrupt everything I have to say. But Obama was a communist. Because all his policies were communist. But see, what the communists do is that they will use any sort of divide and conquer warfare. So, like, in America, they're using race warfare. Whereas, because they know that that's, like, the big Achilles heel in America is race warfare, right? As opposed to class warfare. So this is their divide and conquer strategy here. And they're going to, because to them, the means justify the end. So it's whatever's going to create dissent within society. So this is like diversity and equity thing that they're doing. This is to create a mediocre mean. You're going to create a complete collapse, create a complete revolution. And this is Marxism. If you really read Marx, that's what this is. So this is what we're experiencing here. Their goal is to collapse Western civilization so they can create a global communist society. And they're doing it in America. They're doing it in Latin America. They're doing it in Europe. They're doing it everywhere. The goal is global communism. And I think that's what Americans aren't really understanding. But if you read enough about, like, Russia during the Bolshevik Revolution, it'll make sense to you. That's what this is. The irony is it's not still in Russia. Russia's moved past it. Putin's not a communist. He knows it doesn't work. He doesn't have it there. That's why anything that's like PC culture, communist, LGBTQ, whatever, he heavily persecutes those people. He does not want it there. He knows it's subversive. And the Chinese are communist in name only. They don't want that stuff in their country, but they'll export it here because they know that it will allow them to have global hegemony. That's what's so dangerous about this. So watch Yuri Bezmenov. I mean, the guy was brilliant. Yeah, he warned the West. So did Alexander Solzhenitsyn. He warned everybody. But Americans were so cozy in the 80s. They were so, you know, they had Ronald Reagan. Here was Ronald Reagan. Everybody talks about Ronald Reagan like he was some sort of, like, saint. The guy was, you know, giving all this lip service to anti-communism while he was busy allowing the export of all of our manufacturers and digging us a hole of debt. So if you really look at Reagan's policies, he shoulders a lot of the blame for where we're at right now because he was not an Eisenhower. He did not give us a firm foundation. He allowed a lot of businesses to leave, which is part of the reason we're in such poor shape right now. He allowed, you know, the deferment of all this debt. This is why we're in bad shape, because of Reagan policies. And nobody wants to call that out. So I was like, yeah, but the times were great. Yeah, sure. Sure, times were great. Lots of liquidity. Yeah, of course, you're offshoring everything. Yeah, it seems great right now. It's great when you're racking up what you get on your credit card. You've got lots of stuff. You're not paying for it. But what about 20, 30 years, which is where we're at right now? But he seemed like such a nice guy. Ronald Reagan, he was not an intellect. The guy read Tom Clancy novels, watched TV. But far be it for me to point out the obvious. Anyway, my rant about Reagan. You know? I'm sorry that I expect a president to be, you know, kind of intellectual. I expect somebody to actually know what he's doing. We hand the country over to him. But he smiled. He did movies with monkeys. He was a great guy. I mean, it's just all been downhill with Eisenhower. So. I'm probably the only, like, former porn actress on the planet who says it's all been downhill since Eisenhower.
You know? Maybe I should try to set up a debate with you and Brandy Love.
Well, Brandy, you know, look, I mean, Brandy and like a lot of those girls, I mean, they're just like, I mean, they're smart because they know what sells. And so they're going to be like, yay, Trump. Oh, I have a Trump t-shirt. I'm like, high tit, you know, like they know what's going to get them money. Right. They like, I'm not knocking their hustle, but I doubt Brandy Love has spent years like reading the biographies of like every, you know, president going back to the revolution. You know what I mean? Like they're, it's just a social media hustle. So, you know, she's a Republican because she lives in the South and, you know, drives a big truck or whatever. And good for her. Fine. My point of view is coming from I've had 5 years in here to do nothing but read and study and try to understand why we are in this terrible, terrible spot. And you're not going to convince me that anybody after Eisenhower was worth a damn. You're not. Because none of them cheered. Like it's like going, okay, go back to Starship Troopers. Not a single one of them was truly in office because of service to the country. None of them really believed in service to others. They were all in it for service to themselves. That's a problem. That's a problem with politics in total. I mean, you know, everyone goes, oh, JFK was a veteran. Barely. He was a rich kid, and they trumped up his war record. They literally passed it. But, you know, Eisenhower was a real deal general. Truman wanted to serve in World War II, and they were like, you're too old. You can't. We're not going to let you back into service. He really wanted to serve. I mean, that says something about someone's character. So he had to, you know, go back and then be president. But, well, Truman didn't even go to college. And he was poor when he left office. What does that say? That's amazing. You know? Well, we're in a very different era now. Well, these guys shouldn't be rich when they leave office. So there's something very broken in our system. I don't know. I mean, I was listening to Trump talk last night, and I was like, this guy's not even a good public speaker. I was listening to his speech at the Super Tuesday, and he's not engaging. I mean, it just goes to show you that social media is more important to people now than public speaking. Because he's not, like, when he said, yeah, blah, 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 he's just kind of droning on and on. And I'm like, this is compelling to people? It's just people don't even listen. They just are waiting for the tweet. Because I'm actually standing at the door just listening to him. And I'm like, this guy doesn't even know what he's talking about. He's talking about something about, you know, getting our oil going, about how we're refining oil from Venezuela, and it's carbon in the air. It was like, he's, huh? We're going to get the oil going. I'm like, this guy, what is he talking about? He had four years. To gut D.C. and to put policies in place that would have fixed a lot of these problems. He shut things down for COVID. He didn't have to do it. But he did it anyway. Color me unconvinced. It's all BS. Oh, but he's better than Biden. But they're all the same. He could have drained the swamp. Did he do it? No. Because he wanted political favors. Just like all of them. Why are we handing the country over to these old guys? And, like, why does this guy have so much power within this party? Why is everybody kissing this guy's neck? He's a huge liability. Isn't anybody going to stand up and say, hey, this guy's got no clothes? The emperor's got no clothes. Who cares about this guy? Don't we have anybody in this country who could do better than this? Why are we trying to elect these 80-year-old people? Is this how pathetic America's gotten?
Well, yeah, I was actually talking to my my godsister the other day, actually, about this, because in South America, where you have a lot of these leaders that are our age, they're actually cleaning shit up.
Yes, exactly.
Like Bulele.
We need somebody who's 40. We need someone who's 40 years old who says, you know what? I don't care about any of you old people. You guys fucked this country up. The reason this country is fucked is because all you old people screwed it all up. And you know what? We're getting rid of all of you. You know what? If you're over the age of 60, you're out. You're out of the Senate. You're out of Congress. You're out. You guys fucked everything up. And you're the reason things are fucked. Not, oh, well, we need somebody who's 80, but you guys fucked it up. No, you're all out. And now we're not kissing the ring. You know, you got like 90 fucking federal counts against you. Get out. It's enough. You guys fucked it up. And you know what? You had 4 years, and you fucking screwed the coup. You two, Biden, both of you are out. How come nobody hits me? Chutzpah. Our entire generation are a bunch of cowards. And hey, by the way, let's talk about the fact that how many hundreds of people are in fucking prison because of this guy. And has he stood up for any of them? No. He's just standing up there droning on and on about stupid fucking oil from Venezuela. Oh, well, we're refining the oil. We're not going to do that. We're going to get... Fuck you. Fuck you, man. You know what? People went to fucking prison for your ass and you're talking about oil. Hey, why don't you stand up there and talk about amnesty, you fucking shit. He's never seen the inside of a fucking prison. Fuck you, man. You know what? What a fucking... And this is the guy... By the way, let's talk about his deferment for bone spurs and his ankles. He wants to talk about... he's a patriot. Oh, this guy, he's done things for the country. No, you haven't. You fucking piece of shit. Stupid, grass-dodging piece of shit. You have no fucking idea what hardship is like. Not one iota. But you spend a fucking day inside of a jail cell. He has no idea. I spent five years in a jail cell in a third world fucking country style lockdown. The guy has no idea. Oh, you want to talk about false allegations? Oh, because he had to pay $88 million to Jeannie Carroll? You know what it's like? You know what it's like to have your fucking life stripped from you? To be called a fucking child molester? To have his life fucking stripped? He has no idea. That's some real fuck persecution. Real persecution. Where the hell are the people my age? We need a real revolution against these fucking old fucks. I'm so sick of these baby boomers. Fuck that. Fuck all of them. We need people our age. So you know what? We're taking this fucking country back. Fuck all of you. No, you guys don't get Social Security. Fuck you. You guys fucked everything up. No Social Security. No welfare. None of it. I don't give a fuck if you starve. I don't give a fuck. You guys fucked it up so nobody gets any money. None. Go to the trash heap. I don't give a fuck. None of you get a goddamn thing. The money's worthless. So you know what? You're all going to have to figure it out. We're starting over. Where's that person? That's what we need. Somebody who takes the bull by the fucking horns and says, we're starting over. Where's that person? We don't have that person? Well, then you know what? I guess America's just going to have to go down in the ash heaps of history, just like Rome. Hey, maybe the Huns will be at the gate. That's China. China and Tatars, the Russians will come from the east and the Huns will come from the west and they'll take us over and Americans will be like, oh, save us. Oh, we're a bunch of bitches. We didn't plan. Oh. And they'll cry because all of a sudden their Popeye's chicken will be $30 a plate and they won't be able to afford it. And you know what? Fuck you guys because you didn't plan ahead. Too fucking bad. Tough shit. Because that's what happens when you tell your children, oh, well, there's no such thing as gender. Oh, there's no such thing as gender? Well, guess what? Guess what? There's no such thing as gender? Well, then your kids are not going to be fit to serve in the military. And so then when the Huns come to the gate and the Tatars come at the gate, and then they'll be like, oh, no, I don't know if I'm a boy or a girl. I don't know how to handle a gun. Well, then guess what? You're dead. Welcome to reality. Wake the fuck up, idiot.
You have 1 minute left.
That's the truth. Because if you tell your kids stupid shit like that, then they're going to end up dead when reality hits them. Read the fucking Bible, idiots. This is going to be the fate of America. The ash heap of history. Dummies. Oh, I don't know. Am I a boy or a girl? Oh, diversity and equity. Well, guess what? The Huns and the Tatars are coming for you. It's a retard. Well, no, maybe Trump will save you with his bone spurs and his little stocked hands. Hmm. Yeah, Trump's going to save you all. Good luck with that. Anyway, fun talking. Love you all. Bye.
Thank you for using.
Thank you for listening to Behind the Walls with MercedesCarrera.com. Don't forget to subscribe to us on Spotify. Like, comment, and share. For more information on her case and to donate and information on how to write to her, go to justiceformercedescarrera.com. That's justice, the number 4, MercedesCarrera.com.